Just, is this font size big enough for everyone? Is the microphone working anyway? Yeah. Maybe. So like this, yeah. Can everybody understand me? Better now? Okay. So, yeah. So last time I introduced you like to the basic concepts, the very basic concepts in Python. The plan for today is to finish the second half of the lecture, showing the other basic principles, and then hopefully in the end we have time to start the homework, so you get a little bit of head start on the second homework. It's already up, and the deadline will be next Thursday, 12, so before the next lecture in a week starts, you should finish the next homework. Just to have a quick recap, so last time we talked about basic types in Python, the semantics of variables and typing, the operators you can use, first-class functions and how methods compare to functions, and then about the collection type that the Python language offers, so like lists, sets, dictionaries, and tuples. So, and today we're going to start with control flow. So, until now we don't really have an option to manipulate the control flow of our program, so it will just run linearly from top to bottom, which is often not desired. So most programming languages provide constructs like if and else, and Python is no exception there. So the syntax here is simply, it's very reduced actually, you just say if, and then the expression that evaluates to a boolean, so either true or false, and then again a colon, and then you have an indented block, and same then for else. So in this case we ask is, so in case 1 plus 1 is equal to 2, we print true, otherwise we print false, so this prints in fact true. Yeah, so you can use all the Boolean operators and expressions that you know from beforehand, and you can put them here, and you don't need parentheses if you, yeah, around this expression. So sometimes it can be helpful that you don't want to make an explicit comparison, but many types actually will evaluate to true or false if evaluated in the context of an if statement. So what we can do is we can say if empty list or false or none or zero, at least one of these is interpreted as true. So, and what will happen here that we instead get printed all of these interpreted as false. So this means if we say if empty list, it is converted or it is evaluated for its truthiness and it is interpreted as false. If you have an element inside a list, it would be interpreted as true. And the same for numbers also. So this can be often helpful if you have an empty collection and then you can write if collection instead of if len collection equals zero. So this is much quicker and more idiomatic, so to say, easier to read. So and here we see a summarization of these truthiness things. So the empty list is in fact, so you see like these are not really equal, so the empty list is not equal to false, but it is just evaluated as false in the context of an if statement or of a conditional. So next up would be conditional assignments. So you can also use this conditional branching expressions in assignment statements. So you can say things like equals or some variable equals this or something else. Or you can say some variable equals this if this else this or so. So this is often a shortcut that you can take. So here we say we have an empty list that we call array, and then we say array or error is either the array or the array is empty. So therefore, this variable will be assigned to array is empty, because first array evaluates to true, to false, and then this goes into the second branch of the expression. So if you put a number here instead, this array is evaluated as true, and then the array is actually assigned to this variable array or error. An important difference that many people find strange when they first come to Python is that there's no switch case statement, as in many older programming languages. So instead, Python just has explicit if, else, and else if constructs. So you can say you can chain an arbitrary number of if statements, so to say, first starting with if, and then the next starting with elif, meaning else if. So if this does not evaluate to true, then the next statement will be evaluated, and this will go on until the first statement is evaluated to true. This induces some repetition, because you always, if you just care about the value of command, you always have to write command equals this, but on the other hand, switch case is often a case or like an opportunity to make errors, because you always have to break outside the switch, and many people forget this, and then it can have bad consequences. So this is really explicit, but in Python it's the philosophy is to make things explicit rather than implicit. So this is just a syntax that you have to use. And then there's also the ternary expression. So you might also know this from Java, where you write like Boolean expression question mark, and then either this question mark this, or either this colon this. And in Python it's a bit more verbose, or like a bit more explicit, where you say, okay, there is, so here we have a number one, and then we want to construct a string. Let's say that print this and say there's 1 gram in a kilogram, and then instead we could say there are 5 grams in a kilogram. So the grammar of the sentence automatically adapts, and we use ternary expressions for this. So we say if the number is one, then we say is, else we say are. And if the number is bigger than one, then we append an S to the string gram. So this is just like an example to use this ternary expression, so to say. So this is here's also what this would correspond to in like languages like Java. So this is the conditional stuff that you can use. And by the way, has everybody found the lecture again on Binder? So because there will be exercises. In a minute, just again, you need to go to not there, actually. You again should go to our lectures repository on scientific programming US, and then click on Launch Binder, and there you get the updated version of the lecture ready to run. Now we can branch in our program, but we still would have to write every chunk that we want to repeat the number of times we want to repeat it. This is, of course, not acceptable, so there are loops in programming language. So loops allow us to rerun the same block of a program several times. And in Python, there are while loops and for loops. So while loop, as you probably know, runs until the condition that is evaluated here is not true anymore. So here in this case we have an input, and we ask as long as the input is not numeric, we should enter a number. So this will also demonstrate the input capabilities of Python. If you want to interact with a program somehow, you can use input, and then a little window will open here, and whatever we enter here, that will be assigned to this variable. So we could say like age, and this is not numeric, and this is also not numeric, and this is also not numeric, but as soon as we enter a number, this will stop, because now the imp variable is numeric, and yeah, the for loop breaks at this point. Some programming languages also have do while loops, where you first execute the loop and only then you evaluate the expression. We don't have this in Python, however, you can easily emulate this by just first executing the statement before by doing the following. So we just say while true, so loop forever. Then we run whatever we want to run first, and then we have the while loop condition down here with an if statement. And as soon as this condition evaluates to true, we break out of the for loop. So break is another keyword here that just stops the current loop that is running. So again, same here. We are first asked. We don't have something assigned here. We can do this until we enter a number, and then it stops. Okay. Then there are also no old style for loops as in Java or C. where you write something like initial value and then condition and then the increment of the value or how the value changes. So instead you can do something like this while. So you start with the initial value, then you put the condition in the while loop, and then you put the increment at the bottom of the loop. This might sound a little strange, however, when we get to for loops soon, so most of the time actually you don't want to use a while loop, you want to use a for loop anyway, and you want to use a special kind of for loop, and this kind of looping is not really needed in Python most of the times. So next we're going to talk a bit about iterators here. Basically as a preparation for talking about for loops. So iterators in Python are things that can be iterated over simply as that. So here we also see now the for loop style. So instead of writing initial value condition increment, you write some simply for value in iterator. So now in each iteration, the next value of this loop will be bound to the value or the variable that you put here. So in this case, we iterate over the list, and for each iteration, we print the entry that is in the list or print the next entry. So this is the kind of loop that you use most of the times, and most of the times you iterate over collections that you defined before, and this is way more cleaner than working with like numbers and indices. Because most of the time in like older programming language you do something like this and then you use I as an index to a collection, so and then you say okay, collection at position I, but this is much better if you simply directly iterate over the entries of the collection. So interestingly, strings are also iterable, so if you say for entry in string you get like each character of the string, and in general everything that is iterable is something that has the attribute dunder iter. So we will later, or actually just next week, talk about these dunder methods in general and how they implement the nice Python code that we write under the hood. But for now, you can just know that iterators are everything that do have this attribute and that respond to the function iter. So using iter will actually get you the iterator of an object, and then you can call next of this object and you will get the next entry from the iterator just one by one. So in this case we see, okay, the type of this iter of the list is list iterator, and then when we call next on this iterator it will always give us the next value. So we can call this multiple times and it will always give us the next value in the iterator. And this is what implicitly happens when we write a for loop like this. So we first, the object is converted to an iterator, and then next is called on this object until we don't have any more elements. So when you want to explicitly iterate over a bunch of numbers, you don't have to write a list that contains all the numbers, it would be very annoying, but instead there's a function called range. And we see, so if we say range of 6 and then we convert it into a list and print it, then we can also maybe make this a little bit bigger still. So when we do this, we get a list of the values from 0 to 5. So again, Python indices start at 0, so this is why the first value is 0. And then the last value is exclusive, so it's not included in this here. And the type of range is simply range. And when we want to use this in a for loop, we can simply say for I in range 6, and we get like the first 6 numbers starting at 0. Then you can also say at which value you want to start. So you can say, okay, this is basically the same syntax as we had for slicing in lists. So when you want to slice a list, you have these 3 arguments that you can pass to the square brackets. So you can put start, stop, and step. And the same you can pass to range, so you can say start at 2 but stop at 6, so only include 5. And you can also say start at 2, stop at 6, but only every second value. So when we do this, we see here, okay, this is just range 6, this is range from 2 to 6, and this is range from 2 to 6, step 2. And what's also notable is that the variable that is used here in the for loop is not destroyed after the for loop, but it's still available even after the for loop terminated. So this is not not a separate block of the program that just runs as the rest of the program runs. So what's interesting about range is that it's like a lazy iterator or generator, which we'll also talk about next week. So this means that the values that are generated by it are not pre-allocated, but they are just created one by one. So we can say something like this, give us the first 10 values for e in range sysmax size. And sysmax size is the maximum integer that the system can represent, and this is a very large number. But still we can say, okay, give me all the values starting at zero up to this number, but then only break after the first 10, so, and this is really no problem because you do not generate all the numbers before you want to have them. Okay, then another very nice feature of Python is enumerate. So often you want to enumerate over elements of a collection, but you still want to have the index of it. So in this case here we do something, we have all the grades or the the textual description for grades, and now we want to print something like the number so-and-so corresponds to the textual description of the grade and so-and-so. And you can wrap the list here of grades in enumerate, and this will give us two values now in each for loop. So we first, as the first element, we get the number, and as the second element, we get the element from the list that we are iterating over. So, and this makes it very easy to combine then the indices of a collection and the elements of the collection itself, and we can print something like this. And also here you can note that this is in fact just a tuple, so each iteration now returns a tuple, and we kind of unpack this tuple into these two variables, because the tuple only has two elements here. Yeah, okay, so for now, we just have a small exercise here, what you should do is, you should loop over the numbers from 1 to 10, and print the number even if the number is even, and print the number, and also print the number and odd if the number is odd. So, as a very important feature, we have a countdown now, where you can see how much time you have, so for this, let's say I give it 3 minutes, and you can try it out and see if you understand or understood loops and iteration here. who was already able to construct a for loop that does this. Okay, very nice. So what was your strategy? Anyone? Yeah, very nice, actually. Almost like nicer solution than what we have. I mean, for getting the numbers from 1 to 10, you can change the arguments to range, so that you start at 1 and end at 10. But for printing, you can use even a conditional assignment here or conditional expression inline. But otherwise, you're just checking for modulo, and that's just to demonstrate the basic capabilities of looping and branching here. Okay, so until now we have no way to really reuse the programs that we write. So if we want to do something similar to what we already did, we have to copy the code and paste it somewhere else. And this is obviously the most unmaintainable approach you can take, because if you want to make a change in one snippet of the code, you have to go to all other snippets and you will most surely forget one. So every programming language implements abstractions over your code that you can reuse. You have to reuse chunks of your program. And for this, Python has functions and classes. And we already talked a bit about functions, but now we want to go a bit more into detail of how you can construct them yourself. So we already said the basic syntax is you define the name of the function, and then in parentheses the names of the arguments, and then in the function body, which is indented by four spaces, you can do you can write your chunk of the program, and in the end you return the return value that you want to return from the function. So in this case it's just a multiply function which just applies the multiplication operator, but as a function, so to say. So we can multiply the values 4 and 3 and we get 12, and we will see that the type of multiply is in fact a function. If we forget to specify a return value, the function will implicitly return the value none. So in this case here we have a function which prints a text with some indentation in front of it, so some white space here, but you see we don't have a return statement at the end of the function. Now we can still say assign some return value to the return value of that function, and if we print it we get the value none. So, and none is just the value that represents things that don't really exist or aren't really assigned to anything yet. But so just that you know that you never have no return value, implicitly will always have at least none. And then it's also possible to return multiple values from a function, and this is thanks to the availability of tuples. So we can simply write a function like plus minus one, so that will give us a number, we'll get a number, and it will subtract one from the number, and it will also add one to the number. And then we can write something like plus minus one of 10 and assign the return, assign what the function returns to A and B. And here we say simply we return two things separated by a comma. And as we discussed last week, so putting things between a comma simply means that it's a tuple, in fact. So what actually happens here is that we return a tuple from this function, and then by putting this syntax here at the side, we unpack the tuple again onto separate variables. So this is a very nice way if you compute multiple things in your function that are somewhat separate, and now you want to return them and directly bind them to separate variables. So just doing this, we get first value is 9, second value is 11. And we see if we look at the type of the return value of plus minus 1 of 10, we get that it's a tuple. So next up, we're going to talk a bit about making the intent of your functions explicit. So now you have a chunk of your program that you can reuse, but you still need to know what the chunk actually does. Both for yourself and also for others that read your program. So Python has a very nice feature that it has documentation directly inbuilt into the code. So what you do is you write a function, or when you write a function, you write a multi-line string just below the signature definition of your function, so just below the first line. And there you write just a textual description of what the function does. So in this case, we have a function say hello that returns a string where we say good time and people, and so, and we say, okay, this function says a greeting. This is useful for engendering goodwill, for example. So, and when we have this function, we can later on use the help on this function. So we can use the question mark, and we get the doc string that we put here in this function now here. And what implicitly happens that the string that we put here is bound to the attribute underscore underscore doc underscore underscore, which is in which in Python lingo is pronounced as dunder doc, so for double underscore doc, so we say dunder doc, and we see that here the same string that we put here is really appended here as a string object. For making more explicit doc strings, it's good to use some kind of doc string convention. So you maybe do not just want to document what your function is doing, but also what the arguments are supposed to do, because it's very important if you just get a function and then you want to call this function, you need to know what kind of arguments you need to put in there to get a sensible result. So, and for this you can use conventions like the Google docstring style, and there's also a NumPy docstring style, but we are going to use Google here. And simply what you do is you write args colon, and then you put the arguments here and put a textual description for each argument. So in this case we just say time is the time at which to say hello, and people is the people to say hello to, and in the end we write returns a greeting. So, and this is now just the same function. This is like really just part of the documentation now. When we expect this, inspect this, we can look at it as before. So now we have the whole doc string here and the help. And the nice thing about using such a doc string convention is that there are now external tools that can render your entire program as a standalone documentation. So there's a tool called Swings, and when you write a program and you use this doc string convention, you can run the program and then you will be generated an HTML documentation that just contains the doc strings. So people can just browse your entire functionality of your program without directly interacting with your code. And we will later see a lot of such generated documentations, because all projects that we will be using use that kind of documentation. So you will also get used to this. So now a kind of new thing or new development in Python is that you know that Python is not explicitly or statically typed. So in fact, here we have two variables here, and we can say hello, I don't know, or we can say good afternoon. In this case, not sure if the example good afternoon people. In this case, we are using string concatenation here, but in theory, so, or still it works, if we just put a 2 here, we get a type error because we cannot concatenate a number to a string, but we don't get an error from the function that says, oh, I'm expecting a variable of a type string instead. So this is not happening. Only once the code actually crashes, we get to know that we did something wrong. And to make life a little bit easier explicitly for writing more complex programs, there are no type hints. So you can optionally put behind your arguments a colon and then the type of the argument that you expect to get. So in this case, we say here we expect a variable called time of type string, a variable people of type string, and we will return, this is what this error means here, arrow means also a string in the end again. So, and this can really help, because there are now external tools that can, before you actually run your program, can kind of like a compiler run through your program and check if you really use the functions in the way that they are expected to be used. So, however, still at runtime, this is completely ignored. So You can use an external tool that will show you the errors. However, if you don't use it and just have the annotations here, maybe for documentation purposes, and you do then something again like this, so this function just to show this again. Now these type hints are now part of the signature of the function. So this is true, however, we can still run this with a 2 and we still get the same type error as before, and the program only crashes at the point where we actually run the code that doesn't work. So this is somewhat in the direction of having more, of having saver code, but you don't need to use it if you don't want to and still can benefit from the dynamic nature of the Python language. So then a word about arguments. So if you define arguments on your function and then you call the function only with partial or with not all arguments that you specified before, it will not work. You will get a type error that says, okay, the function that you're calling requires a positional argument people, but you didn't pass it. So however, what you can do is put default arguments for arguments that you don't want to always pass. So in case you most of the time say hello to your friends anyway, you can say the argument people equals the string friends as a default. And then you have this function defined, and then you can say hello with default of afternoon, and then automatically the value friends will be by default bound to the variable or to the argument people. You can still use a different argument and it will work as it did before, but you don't have to pass it, so yeah. And here be aware that when you specify default arguments, you don't put spaces around the equal sign. So this is again just a convention of PEP 8, so to have a clear distinction between where you actually assign a variable and where you just specify a default value. So make sure not to put spaces around default value assignments here. Okay, so then another question is whether Python is call by value or call by reference. So what does this actually mean? That's maybe the question. So when having So when having a function where you say, let's say simply an addition function of A and B that does really nothing than just returns A plus B, and then you call this function with the arguments 1 plus 1 and 2. So there are now two options how you could evaluate this. So you could either say call by value. This means that first the expressions here are resolved, so this will be substituted, so to say, by a 2, and then only the code will be executed, so and then we will do somewhat here below 2 by 2. Or it could also be possible that you pass just a reference to this, and then below here you actually evaluate 1 plus 1 plus 2, and you will only at the very last moment resolve all the expressions to actual values. So this would be called by reference then, because you only pass a reference to the thing that you specified when you called the function. So this is a distinction that many programming languages make. And now the question is, what kind or what does Python do in this case? So and the question is, or yeah, we could also see the difference here again. So we have the function add a number to a list, and then we say, okay, we pass a list, we append a value to the list, and then we print what the list is inside the function, and here we print what the list is outside the function. So in this case we see that both inside and outside the function, the list that was initially empty now changed to contain the number 42. Now when we have the same without having a list, but just with a, so to say, atomic type like a string, and we say we assign internally the string to a new value, and then we again print what the value is inside and outside the function. We see that inside the function it has a new value, but outside the function the thing still has the old value. And from this we see that this would be like call by reference, where you pass only a reference to the object, and then outside the function you have still the same reference to the object, but in this case we have more call by value semantics, where we have both the new value and the new value inside the function, but maintain the old value outside of the function. And therefore the answer is that Python is neither call by reference nor by value, but instead it's something like call by object reference. And this is again relates to what I talked about last time, how lists are constructed internally or represented internally. So if you pass like an atomic type to a function, you will only make a new reference at this point here. So the old value still is kept in memory, and the old value is also kept in memory. But in this case, where you pass a reference to the list only has a reference to other objects. So and when you change this reference, this will also change the value of the list outside of the function. So because of this, we can say that Python is somewhat a mixture, and it really depends on whether the arguments that you pass to a function are mutable or immutable. So if they are mutable, then all the modifications that you make inside of functions will also affect your references outside of the function. If you pass only immutable values, then there's no way for the function to change the values outside of it. Yeah, and there's also a link where you can read more about it. And then coming back to default values, there's one important caveat that you should keep in mind. So could be that you have a function where you want to append a single value to that function, and then you want to print it. So as a default, you say, okay, if you don't pass anything, this should just be the empty list. So and if we print this 10 times, now what happens is that we get non-reproducible results, but with each call to the function, we get a list with one more value appended, even though we just append one value here. So and this is because what happens is that if we specify a mutable default argument here, so the default argument will be bound to this object, the empty list, and if we now do not pass an argument here, it will to this default argument will append, and then because the argument is mutable, it will be kept in memory, and so the next time it will be called, the default value will still point to the same reference, to the same object. So each time we get a new entry appended to this list. So because of this, you shouldn't really use the mutable arguments as default values. This is something that can really create strange things to happen. However, sometimes you just want to have something like a mutable or default argument, so have an empty list as a default. So what you then need to do is, instead of passing explicitly the default value here, you set the default value to none, which just means, okay, not really specified. And then inside of your function, you check if the default or if the argument is none. And if it is none, then you assign the mutable default argument that you initially wanted to assign. And because of this, nothing can happen. And if we do this 10 times, we will only get lists that contain a single value here. So, yeah, again, we have a small exercise for you. So the idea is here to write a nicely documented add function that by default adds the number 10. So it adds two numbers, and by default it adds number 10, and you should also write a doc string and annotate the arguments with type hints. So let's say for this, I don't know, writing the function will probably not be so hard, but writing the documentation always takes time, so let's give it 4 minutes. Thank you. Okay, so who was able to write a function that adds 10 by default? Okay, who also wrote documentation for it? Nice, okay. Yeah, so the solution is quite simple. Actually, I didn't write the documentation myself. And probably should have done if I asked it for you, of you. However, you just have define add and then you say b equals 10 by default and then just return a plus b and then you can simply say things like add 1 and by default it will add 10. Yeah. Okay, so then another nice part for defining functions are star arcs and star star quarks. So what does this mean? This is for defining variadic functions, so functions that define a variable number of arguments. So, for example, what you could do, you could have something here that says scream, add a number of strings, and then for each... this is actually not used here. Right? So for each string, you would print the string in upper cases and then print the next string. So, and then you can say things like call the function with a variable number of arguments. So you can say, hey, you argument, and it will print all of them in uppercase. But we can also print or put other strings behind here, and it will also print those. And you can do this infinitely and also have less arguments, so we're not constrained to a fixed number of arguments. So it depends. This can be useful in some cases, especially if you have a lot of possible configurations arguments that you don't all want to pass, or for inheritance, which we will look at later. But often it's also easier or more explicit if you require a single argument that is a list, than have a variable number of arguments. And similarly, the star star operator. Does the same, but for keyword arguments. So you can have then a variable number of arguments for arcs, and all the rest will be bound to a dictionary called quarks inside the function. So we print here, we print all the arcs that we get, and then we print for each two items in quarks.items. So .items, if you remember, was the method to get both the keys and the values from a dictionary. And then we print the first and the last. And we see here that this is a list, will be transformed into a list when called like this. But this, a dictionary, will be internally turned into a dictionary when you call the function like this. So yeah, this you can also use the other way around. So if you have a function that expects a number of arguments, but you only have them in a collection. So in this case, we have the arguments 3 and 6 that we want to pass to range. And instead of writing args at 0 and args at 1 that we pass to list, we can simply say range of star args, and it will internally first unpack the collection that we pass to the function and apply them correctly to the arguments that the function defines. So we get here all the values from 3, 4, and so to say to 6 in this case. And the same you can do for keyword arguments, where you say if you have a dictionary and a list, you can use a star to unpack the list and two stars to unpack the dictionary. So we pass this to the function that we defined up above. And here we see that now all of these are treated as default arguments. So basically, maybe to make this more explicit again, what is this? So really doing this is the same as doing this here, where you say, okay, args at 0 and args at 1. And same for dictionaries. And then another very useful function that you also often need when you do iteration is zip. So what often happens is that you have two collections. So here we have a bunch of people and we have their ages. And now we want to print the people together with their ages. However, we cannot really iterate over the arguments in pairs like this yet. And this is where zip exists for. So zip is in fact like a zipper that like zips together the two lists, and it will give you the first entry here combined with this first entry, this first the second entry with this second entry, and this third entry with this third entry. So and then we can zip those, and then we can again unpack those on two different variables, and then we can print those, and then we get the names correctly matched to the ages that we defined here above. Okay, so much for like arcs and quarks and zipping stuff. And now let's get to the last part of this lecture, which is about defining classes and object orientation. So there are no more questions regarding functions and arguments stuff. Okay. So for classes, it's really the way to define new types in the language. So types, as we know, combine data with behavior. And this is really the most powerful abstraction that you can use in the language to really describe the objects of the domain you are working with, and then neatly encapsulate everything in a sensible way, and then have programs that read very nicely. So, and to define classes in Python, so you just write class, the name of the class, colon, again, and indentation, and then a block. So as for functions, so it's basically the same definition as for functions, except that you do not have arguments, and you write class instead of def, and then the rest is the same to a certain extent. So again, we can have doc strings on the class, that is also important. And then in this case, we just write pass, which means in Python is just a statement for not doing anything. But we couldn't also not write nothing here, because we need to write something in a block, because otherwise it's not it's a syntax error. But we can just say that we don't want to do anything here and just have an empty class. And then we can instantiate that class. So a class is like a template for a new object. It defines what kind of data and what kind of behavior the objects should have. And then you can use this as a kind of factory to make many instances of this type. So here we make an instance of our class, and we also do this by calling the class, so by writing parentheses after the class. And then we get that the type of my instance is now my class, as expected. So the instance that we created is now of the type of its class. And this also we can find here if we ask for if it is an instance of, and in fact the instance is an instance of the class that we created earlier on. And again, we can use the question mark to get the doc string and information about the instance, and it will also show us a type here. So this is not very useful yet, so we need to add some methods and attributes to our classes. So what you usually do when you make a new class, you make a so-called constructor that describes how the class will be initialized. So in Python, you do not really have a constructor in the true sense, but you rather have an initializer. So actually, when you make a new class, the class is automatically constructed for you, and then you just define a function that's called dunderInit, and there you can add some attributes to the class that it didn't have before, but it's already created in memory at this point. So therefore, it's not really a constructor, but rather an initializer. So for, and also that's a method of the class. If you write, or if you define a function inside a class, it will be a method of that class later on. And every method that you define on a class has self as its first argument. So self is the equivalent of this in Java or C, not C, but C++. And this is just a reference to the instance itself. And in other programming languages, you don't have to pass this explicitly. Like, this is always available in any kind of method, but in Python, you really have to make it explicit and say, okay, self is the first argument to all of my methods. And then here, what we do, we have a class that just has an initialization method where it prints itself, and then we also print the type of self. So, and this init method is implicitly called when you create a new class, when you create a new instance of the class. So when you call the class to make a new instance, init will be called. And all the arguments that you pass here will also be passed to init. And here we just see that we print self. So here we see the string representation of that object. So if we print the instance later on, we see the same string that we get here. And so this by this, the object has a reference to itself and can operate on itself also. And the type is still my class 2 in this case. So now we want to actually now add some attributes and define some behavior. So this class now has a single attribute, which is called number, and it has the possibility to change the number that it holds. So here we again have an initialization method, where we now have a second argument called number, and this argument is also now available when you construct a new instance of this class, and then you often your initializers look like, okay, self dot a equals a. So most of the time you just want to assign all the attribute or all the arguments that you pass to the initializer to some attributes inside the class. And then here we have a second method on that class that defines some behavior that says it can change the number to a new value, and here we set self.number to a new value. Yeah. And so we can make two instances of our new class here, which are initialized by 2 and 3. And here note, while we have self as an explicit first argument to our methods, we don't have to pass self here as an argument to the constructor. This would also be impossible because at the point where we call this, self is not even existent. So self is a reference to the instance, and with this statement, we only create the instance. So Python will inject the instance there on its own, but we have to make it explicit when we want to declare a method. So when we execute the statement, this function will be executed. So first an instance will be constructed, it will be passed to init, and then on that instance we can set the number attribute, and then we can later access this number attribute by calling instance.attribute, so in this case c and b.number. And we get back the two numbers that we pass to the initializer of that class. And we can also call the other method that we defined. So we can call change number on, for example, object B, and we pass a new value here. And now the number will have the value, string new value. And again, here we see an example that type checking is not strict in Python, so you would expect maybe number to be some kind of number, but you can also pass any kind of value here and it will just be assigned if you do not check for it explicitly. So this is the basic syntax for classes. So maybe just in general, so it's we will not get really into deep object-oriented programming except maybe next week exercises a bit. But so the goal of this course is not to talk about software architecture and software engineering, but still it's very important to know the basic semantics of Python classes, because all the libraries that you will use internally use and define some classes, and this way you should have some understanding of how they are designed and how they are constructed. So next important topic when we talk about object-oriented design is inheritance. So when you want to reuse functionality that you have in a class but also want to extend it, you usually use inheritance. So you define a class that has some behavior, and now you want to add some behavior to it, so you have a second class that inherits from the first and adds the behavior that is interesting. So what many programming tutorials do is, instead of actual behavior, they just return strings to simulate some kind of behavior. We are no exception here. So here we will define some animal pedigree. So starting with an animal that is living, and then we have a land animal that inherits from animal. So this is the inheritance syntax. Again, very easy, just in the class definition. You put parentheses here and put all the classes that you inherit from in the parentheses. So in the class animal doesn't have a constructor, it doesn't have an initializer itself, but now land animal has, and it also has the ability to walk, which just returns the string tap tap in this case. So now we can instantiate land animal, and we can look at the type of our animal, and we can still ask if animal is an instance of animal. So we see, okay, that animal is of type land animal, but it's also an instance of animal, and this is, so to say, the semantics of inheritance. So being an instance of a child class also makes you an instance of the parent class if you are actually class inherited from the other class, because this should mean that you still have all the behavior defined on the parent class yourself. So for example, if someone writes a function that expects an animal and you write in the doc string, okay, give me some instance of animal because I want to call is living at some point, it is just enough to know for me that it is an animal. I don't know, I need to know whether it's a land animal or some other kind of animal. For me, it's just important that it is living and not the additional behavior that some child classes might define. So, yeah. Yeah, again, we can also look at the other attributes and methods that we define. So we can warp, we can ask whether we have legs. Okay, so now to make it very advanced, Python also supports multiple inheritance. So you cannot just have one parent, but you can have multiple, as we all also do. We can also have two or even more. So a class can have two or more parents to combine different behaviors. So in this case, what we do, we can define a water animal that doesn't have legs, but that can swim instead. So it's like a fish. And now we can make an amphibian that inherits both from the land animal and the water animal. And doesn't define any behavior on its own, but it just like combines this behavior. So in this case, we can ask if it is we can make an instance of it, and we can ask if it is an instance of land animal and an instance of water animal. And in fact, it is an instance of both, because it inherited from both. And we can also walk and swim with this instance of this, and now the question is just whether it has legs. So we saw that a water animal doesn't have legs, but a land animal usually has legs. So now that we inherited from both, what will happen to this attribute? So just to have a bit of background here, so the situation that we are facing now is that we have the amphibian here at the bottom, and somehow here we have the land animal. And here we have the water animal. And at the top you also have, again, the animal. So now the inheritance goes like this, so to say, making this often seen diamond shape where you have two classes inheriting from the same, and then we have another class inheriting from both, and now the question is who should take precedence, and really the details are not so simple, but in cases like this where we just have two conflicting attributes, so we have here legs and we have no legs here, and what we just do, we look at the order in which we inherited. So we go we look at the definition and we see that we first inherited from the land animal. So this is what we take, and then we this overrides then everything that will be defined in other classes that we inherited from. So we will see that the amphibian in fact has legs as would be expected, and this is how multiple inheritance works. So, and it can be a very powerful way to have different composable parts of your programs and then make new classes that combine behavior allegiantly, but usually just need to know that it's possible to have. So as a final exercise, let's make now a bird that is able to walk, fly, and also has legs. And you should define this class bird without defining any behavior directly on the class, but just by inheriting from other classes. And so this works very similar to the amphibian example, and you can also look at the hint if you want to. Yeah, and for this, let's say 5 minutes, because this class stuff can be very confusing at times. So, okay. Still muted? Yeah. Okay. Was I muted all the time? I don't know. Who was... Sometimes you wonder. Who was able to complete the exercise? Nice. Yeah, so just to show the hint, obviously the strategy was to have a new class of animal that's an air animal and that somebody finds a fly method. And then your code could look something like this, where the air animal just has a fly method that makes some flying sound. And then the bird inherits both from land and air animal. And then you can fly and walk with the bird, and it also will have legs. Great. Some final thing about this inheritance stuff. So sometimes you have sometimes you need to extend the behavior of a certain method, but you do not want to completely override the method. So for example, we could have a class frog that is a subclass of amphibian and that eats flies and is sometimes also poisonous, but that should still have all the behavior that was defined in the amphibian initializer. So if we look at the amphibian initializer, we inherited the one from land animal, so we say has legs equals true. So, and now the problem is, if we don't do this here and we ask finally if it has legs, we will get an attribute error, because the attribute has legs is not even defined on that frog, because that is all that happened in the initializer here. However, what we can do, we can use the super function, which will give us a reference to the next class in the inheritance chain. So this will look at amphibian and will see, okay, now who am I inheriting from? And we will see that this will be a reference to the class amphibian, and amphibian has the initializer in which has legs is set, and then you can pass all the arguments that this initializer needs to this initializer here explicitly, but not self again. So in this way it will work, and you will basically call the function of the parent class completely. And here it can be sometimes useful to use args and quarks, because you can have in child classes any number of arguments that the parent classes did not necessarily have, and you just pass everything that's left to the parent classes and they should handle it. So if you want to know more about multiple inheritance and why this is super cool, you can look at the talk Super Considered Super, linked here. That's recommended if you want to do more with inheritance. However, for now, let's just talk about the visibility aspect of object-oriented programming in Python. So in languages like Java, you have things like private attributes and public attributes and protected attributes, and this determines like who is actually able to access the attributes that you expose. And in Python, you simply do not have this, actually. So there is no such thing as a public or private attribute. Everything is just an attribute of the class, and everyone can access those attributes. However, there are, again, just conventions that define some kind of privacy. So having private attributes is a useful option most of the time, but the Python approach is to rather rely on conventions and the people acting in a sensible way and common knowledge, instead of just strictly enforcing any kind of rules. So what you can do if you want to make a variable private, you can put an underscore in front of it. So you simply make a name for the variable and you put an underscore, and because of this, everyone will know that this variable is not really supposed to be used. You can also put two underscores in front, which will invoke some strange name mangling mechanism. So let's look at this class here. It has an attribute underscore underscore super private and underscore semi-private. And then when we call semi-private, we can call this. We can also call an attribute like this, but we cannot call super private. This is because if you put two underscores, it will turn this attribute into this attribute, putting the name of the class in between. So this means that it's really kind of private, because no one knows anymore how this attribute is called, and semi-private is more compared to protected, so where you say like, okay, subclasses should still be able to use this attribute, but not the same. But actually this is not needed most of the time, so in Python you are more interested in writing code that actually does something than defining interfaces that are very abstract. And yeah. So actually, like this super private, I wouldn't use at all, and semi private, I use often if you just have a class and that has internal, so to say, internal attributes that you don't want to expose to others. So, so for example, if we look at this animal example, so for example, fly without an underscore would be part of the public interface. So if I give you the bird class, you should be able to make a new instance and you should be able to call fly on it, because it's part of the public interface. But maybe also the air animal does something internally, like how it implements the flying. So maybe it uses wings, or maybe it uses some kind of rocket power or so. But you are not really interested in this, you are just interested that it flies. So what we could do then, have a so to say semi-private attribute or method where we define how it's actually done, but you just want to be interested in that it flies. So when we make an update of the library and we change the internal behavior of how we fly, so say we go from wings to rocket power, which is now much faster, but still the behavior of the air animal is the same and you do not need to change your code. So it's always advisable to keep the interface or the public interface very small, so you do not have too many dependencies, but for our use cases here it's not so important. Just that you know, when you see an underscore in front of a method, it usually means that you are not really supposed to use it, because it means it's not part of the public interface, and the next update of the library could simply delete this method or attribute, and then your code will break if you make an update. Okay. Yeah, and this is also summarizes the typing philosophy of Python. So Python typing is often referred to as duck typing, and this can be summarized in the sentence, if it looks like a duck and quacks like a duck, it probably is a duck. So this means that you do not rely on arguments being of some specific type, but just implementing specific behavior. So in this case, we have an example of a duck-like animal, and where we say, okay, it has two attributes, looks like and quarks like, which returns both duck. And then we would say, okay, if it has these two attributes and they are equal to duck, then we can probably use them. So, and this is actually a very, very nice thing to have. So, for example, so a good example that maybe see right at the end of the lecture is scikit-learn, which is responsible for machine learning in Python. You have two methods, fit and predict, and so you can fit on some data and you can predict some data. And now if you want to make a class yourself that you somehow make work with the other classes defined in the library, you just have to define something that also defines fit and predict. You don't have to inherit from the classes of scikit-learn and override some behavior and whatever, so you just need to implement the behavior, but we do not really look at the type of things. So yeah. So in this case, this is what we do next week. So, and just as a final remark that I have, a small word on commit messages. So because I saw like many different ways people did commit messages here, just to talk a bit about the conventions that you usually have for commit messages, because I really think it's important to stick to conventions so everyone can read everybody else's code. So when you want to write a useful commit message, you usually stick to these conventions. And the most important here are that in the first line you just have 50 characters, and then you have a blank line, and then you write a body if you want to that has 72 characters, and you start with a capital letter in the headline, and you also write in imperative mood or imperative tense or whatever. So this means that more or less every commit message should be read as something where you can say, okay, if I apply this commit, it will and then commit message here. So you could say something like, if I apply this commit, it will solve the homework. What you shouldn't do is, if I apply this commit, I solve the homework. It will solve the homework. So this is not the idea here. And really, why we do this is because this is like the shortest form that you can have if you have if you write in imperative mood. So if you write in past tense, you will already have often two characters just spent for writing in past tense and not conveying any meaning. And if you only have 50 characters, then it's good to stick to this very short form. And it will also save you the most of the time. This is something that even professional programmers, for some reason, can't get right. So I just also have like a blog post here, but so just try to stick to this commit messages and make it a habit, so and then you will be good for the rest of your programming career. So finally, if you want to know more about the basic Python stuff, you can also look at this tutorial, which is again like 3 hours or so on the basics of Python. So if you didn't get enough yet, so let's see. So we unfortunately only have 10 minutes for starting with the homework, but still you can start. I will just show it to you. So we have an announcement here in the StudIP session. Here's the next link. You can click here and accept the homework. And yeah, I already accepted it. So you can go to your GitHub repository that was then created for you. And I didn't update the headline. However, this is meant to be homework 2, just to be sure. And yeah, so this week's homework will be about finding prime numbers. So you need to do a bit of iteration, a bit of counting with operators and modulo stuff. And we also link to Stack Overflow answer here, how you can actually implement this. However, this answer will be in Java. So if you cannot come up with a strategy yourself, you can look at this answer and try to translate the Java code to Python, and it's also totally fine. Yeah, so if you want to, you can now start. We still have like 8 minutes to go, or we can also stay here a bit longer. And yeah, then and the homework is due to next Thursday at 12, as I already said. Okay, yes. Okay, so you don't need to shut down the kernel. So what you best can do, let's just try it out here. So what you can either do is open a new terminal here via the launcher and put terminal here, and then you can just activate your environment again and run PyTest from here. So that's the preferred way to do it, at least for me. However, what you can also do if this, like for some people, I saw that this console inside Jupyter is not working because of whatever reasons, then you can just open a new terminal, right? There's nothing that constrains you to having a single terminal open. So you can just like make a new CMD or make a new terminal, and then you just navigate to the folder again in which your homework is, and then you can run PyTest from there.